Welcome back to another Friday Reads, where I talk about what I've read, what I'm reading, what I hope to get to next, and how is it halfway through the month, guys? Oh boy, hopefully by the time this video goes up, I'll have read two books, but so far this month, I have read one book. So obviously this was a case where the vacation did not lend itself to more reading time, but that's fine. If you want to know what I was up to when I was back home, last week's video I talk about the amusement park I went to, some other 4th of July fun stuff, board games we played, etc. I am in front of my stepfather's bookshelves, and he has some interesting shelving choices, to say the least. I heavily judge his shelves. Not the actual, like, shelf. I love the shelves. They're floor-to-ceiling wood. Beautiful. Just how he shelves them. But let's talk about the one book that I have finished this month, and that's The Night Watchman by Louise Erdrich. I love this author. I talked about that a lot last week too. Like, here's my copy of La Rose, although I think I actually own the ebook too. I hate this a lot. But this is the paperback cover, which I really like, and the hardback cover I don't like as much, so I don't know what I'm gonna do there. But I love La Rose, and The Night Watchman was also amazing. It has won a Pulitzer, if you're one of those people who likes to occasionally read a Pulitzer Prize winning book. This book, we read it for book club, and everyone really loved it. It got like a 4.25 average in book club. Like, I think one person rated it 3.5. That was the lowest rating. This is a historical fiction in the 1950s. The Night Watchman is directly inspired, based off Louise Erdrich's grandfather, who basically brought people together, raised money to fight Congress's attempt at emancipating, really terminating the Chippewa tribe, I think specifically the Turtle Mountain tribe. I am blanking on the specific name of it, the Turtle Mountain Reservation in North Dakota. And I thought that it would be more based off that, but per usual, when Louise Erdrich writes a story, it's about a community. And I love the community. I love so many of the characters. I love how spiritual and religious the characters are. These are characters full of faith, which, I mean, I'm agnostic. I'm not someone who's very tied to religion, but it's been a long time since I've read a book where characters really trust their faith and their religion, and that is very true here, and it makes a lot of the decisions that Louise Erdrich makes make sense, and it really added a layer to the story. So there's going to be parts that maybe some people will think of as fantastical or magical realism, but to the characters, it's related to their religion and everything like that. But it's about a community. Not only do you have Thomas, the Night Watchman, you have Patrice, who is a young woman who wants to be independent from the reservation, and everyone calls her Pixie, and she wants to be called Patrice. She is both so independent and strong-willed and so naive. The combination is fascinating. One of my favorite characters doesn't get introduced to, like, halfway through, Millie, who is a very focused, mathematically minded student who they use to help go to Congress. It's a really lovely story about community. And there are some things that I didn't completely love about the ending, mainly just some relationship trajectories, but even talking about those in book club, they all made sense. I need to read more by Louise Erdrich. She has so many books out, so maybe it's one of those things where I'll try and read one a year, and maybe one day I'll catch up. I love how she writes, and I love how she creates a scene and writes characters. Like, this is a book that goes through the seasons, so, you know, I think we start in late summer, we get fall, you go into winter. It's really, I think, hopeful historical fiction, despite all of the harsh, raw topics. Like, this has a lot of difficult content. It does not necessarily back away from it, but it also is kind in its delivery, is what I would say. Like, we do have discussions about what happens to Native American women in the world, you know, that they go missing and what's happening there. We have discussions about the boarding schools, what happens to the children there. Like, there are things that are brought up in here that are very dark and obviously not ideal, that Congress wants to terminate this tribe. And Congress did successfully terminate many tribes. So there's just a lot that I really value in this book. I'm glad that I own it so I can reread it one day, just because, like, it's one of my favorite authors because it's just the way she forms sentences. Like, this is not a fast-moving story. It's a slow-moving community story. And I loved reading it. I loved sitting down and reading, like, 50 pages at a time. It was great. And it's very similar in that way with LaRose for me. Like, I was reminded a lot of LaRose. The other one I read by her, Future of the Living God, is very different in that it actually is hyper-focused on one character perspective and is a little bit epistolary, which I still liked, but it's just the most different of the works that I've read, which is only three. So that's the thing I've finished. I put on pause Hero of Ages, which I was telling you guys about last week, because I am reading and I'm like almost done. I'm probably going to finish it today. She Who Became the Sun with Abby Salter. This book is both working for me really well and also probably not going to be like a favorite of all time. It can be both. Like, I foresee it being a 4, maybe 4.5 star, depending on what the ending does. So when I read the first chapter of this book, it's dark. That was some of the darkest presentation start to a book that I have ever seen. I remember I not only messaged Abby because we were buddy reading it, but I messaged Judith, who I knew had read it, and was like, what is this chapter? Like, oh my gosh. Like, there are some books that are trying to be edgy in their darkness, and like, you're like, well, I don't know, this just feels like, you know, you're just like pretending it's dark. But then there was just the authenticity of the poverty and the famine, and just, it was dark. I definitely feel like I have a sense of where things are, but it took me a while to get used to all the names. And it did do this thing where our main point of view is the Mulan character everyone talks about, and we're with her. The first part of the book, it's split into 3 parts, and then when you get to part 2, you get more point of views. They suddenly show up, which is cool. I actually like a lot of them, but it was unexpected. And there's definitely a lot of things that I can tell are based off cultural stuff that I don't know, that like some things that if it was written in a Western narrative, I'd be like, this is weird. But I think it makes sense in the context of culture. But the one stylistic thing that might also be a homage to maybe different like ancient Chinese texts and legends, and but to me it's kind of like a slight annoyance, is as someone who does not visualize when they read, visualization descriptors can be really jarring to me if they're done in a certain way. So normally if someone just lists a bunch of stuff, I'm fine. Sometimes people can evoke an atmosphere and a feeling, and that's good for me. This author likes to use a lot of similes. And some of the similes just don't make sense to me. I'm just like, wait, what does this mean? Like, some do and some don't, and there's a lot. So it's a stylistic choice that's used in descriptions. And it's prevalent enough that, A, I noticed. Normally, I don't notice writing structure things or writing styles. Like, that's not who I am as a reader. I'm not normally hyper-focused on that. But also, it has occasionally made me have to reread a paragraph. Because I'm like, wait, what did I just do? I just, like, glazed over that. I don't know what happened. So yeah, but I do really like all of the characters I've been presented. I do see why it's been given the Song of Achilles vibe, and I think it's earned. But it's definitely complicated, and I don't know how to describe it. But whoever was on the marketing team actually, I think, did nail that, because it does kind of feel like it. I have no idea where it's going, because I've purposely not looked up stuff about the Ming Dynasty. But I do feel grounded, even though my knowledge of this part in history is so limited. But I feel like the author did a good job of not spoon-feeding me, but like, I have a good sense of the political tensions and what's going on in this story. And again, like I was saying in The Night Watchman, we have lots of characters very tied to their fate and to their religion. And it's, again, something I don't notice often. But I think it makes sense, especially if this is a historical fantasy, and your main character is a monk who believes in fate, like, to have that actually be there. Like, I think a lot of times it comes across in historical fantasies that your characters are just agnostic. They're like the person, like the average person consuming a book, or maybe they're Christian, but it's not like a big part of their decision making. Like here, a huge part of decision making is based off fate and presumption that fate is real and you have to put stuff into it. And I just think that's really interesting. And obviously there is so much commentary about gender in this book. So if that's like a theme you like to dig in and have kind of not be pushed against, but like dig into in its historical context, it's been really interesting. So there's a lot of stuff I'm liking. I think the first part of the book was my favorite for reasons. And then I didn't dislike a lot of the second half, but there's just been more chessboard stuff that happens in military fantasy. Like, it's definitely a military fantasy where we have like this person setting up this conflict and this person trying to do this political intrigue. Like, it's a very political intrigue, military fantasy, setting up campaigns sort of thing. So I'm excited, though, to see how it ends. And so that I should finish that today or tomorrow. So by the time you're seeing this video, I have hopefully finished it, unless, like, I just don't read anything tonight, which could happen. So I paused Hero of Ages, so I don't really have new updates for that. I talked about She Who Became the Sun. I started an audiobook. It's for Jess Owen's nonfiction book club, so I'll leave her announcement video for that down below, and maybe the link to the Twitter, because I think you can find the Discord through the Twitter or whatever. But this is like every 2 months nonfiction book club, so I think we're discussing this end of August, but you can discuss in real time in the Discord, and this is Conflict Is Not Abuse. It's something like that. You guys have a picture. I've been listening to the audiobook, and I mean, to be fair to the author, she said in the introduction that she didn't expect everyone to completely agree with everything she said, and that it's more meant to be engaged with and talked about, which is what we're doing. But, like, it's an interesting thing where I think a lot of us are like, yes, I agree with the premise and the thesis, and but when you get into your personal examples as a human existing in the world, it's weird. There are just some cases where I'm just like, I feel like we're not handling the thesis with as much nuance as you want people to handle situations. Does that make sense? Like, the idea that people should communicate and try to recognize when there is mutual conflict and how to diffuse conflict and maybe be self-aware when they are adding to a situation. Like, all of these things are good, but a lot of these things require everyone to have access to mental health, like, things. Like, to, or just, like, to have access to anything, right? Like, in order for me to be able to handle conflict, I have to feel confident in so many other parts of my life, like finances. I have to have access to my therapist or my antidepressant meds. Or, like, there are so many things that not everyone has access to. So I just feel like there's sometimes in the direct examples a lack of nuance and putting, I think it's not unfair to say someone who is on the other side of the conflict that isn't always seen as the wronged party because of media and everything should take some ownership of how things got there. I'm not necessarily saying that's not true, but I think there's a certain number of lack of recognizing that not everyone has the spoons to do all the things she wants people to do in this book. Like, so it's weird where it's like, on one hand, it's like, yes, I agree with you on principle in some utopian society. These are the type of things I would want to have happen. But when I add into the equation that I live in a country that does not value mental health for everyone or just healthcare for everyone, I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see what more people think. But those are just my initial thoughts. It's quite consumable in audiobook. She's just monologuing. It's kind of like a podcast. So those are the things I'm reading. I should probably finish that nonfiction soon too. I've like read almost half of it in 2 days. It's been pretty easy to listen to at work and on my commute. So what am I going to read next? One of these two things I'm picking up next, and I don't know which one, so I'm going to show both of you. One, Escaping Exodus by Nikki Drayden. This is a gorgeous sci-fi. I'm leaning towards it because it's short, so I'll feel accomplished. But yeah, it's like 310 pages, and it's sci-fi, and I haven't read a sci-fi yet this month, and I don't know, I'm kind of feeling that. There also is The Obelisk Gate, which I should have read by now, and I haven't, because I've been bad at things, so I wouldn't hate picking this up either. I think it's going to depend on my headspace. Like, if I'm feeling like, ooh, I need something new, I will pick up Escaping Exodus. And if I'm feeling like I'm in a reading mood, but I kind of want to just, like, exist in a story I know before, it'll be The Obelisk Gate. So I don't know. Stay tuned to find out. Those are the things. And yeah, back in Boston, it's nice. It's nice to go on vacation, but it's always nice to be home. And I've loved seeing my cats, who have been shunned to a different room for now because they could not stop meowing while I recorded this video. But if you made it this far and you don't have anything you want to say but want me to know you're here, leave an emoji. The Night Watchman kind of looks like a watermelon on the cover, so maybe a watermelon and it's summer. I don't know, do you guys think this reminds you of a watermelon? It reminds me of a watermelon. Otherwise, like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.